I met and spent time with each of the four Beatles. My friendship with John is well documented in this jukebox of recollections. Of the other three, the one that John spoke about with the greatest affection and appreciation was Ringo, who was the oldest and perhaps least acknowledged and appreciated member of the band. For a while, Ringo was my neighbor when I lived in Laurel Canyon in Los Angeles. We visited from time to time, saw each other socially, and one day he agreed to sit down and reminisce about his life as a Beatle. Of the four, he seemed to enjoy reminiscing about the experience more than the others. He has a great sense of humor, a joyous demeanor, and like Paul, continues to tour with his all-star band. Shortly after I conducted this interview at his house one summer afternoon, I flew to Japan to vacation with John and Yoko. I brought the cassettes with me and one evening played them for John. He listened with great interest and an occasional chuckle and did not take exception to any of Ringo's recollections. After John was murdered, Ringo was the first of the group to phone the Dakota to convey his condolences to Yoko and to ask if he and his wife Barbara could come over to offer comfort. I took the phone call, then asked Yoko, and she told me, "Yes, please invite him over." I remember meeting him a block or two from the building and attempting to escort him through the back entrance up the elevator and to her room. I shall never forget his generosity of compassion and support during that dark night. We run into each other from time to time, the opening of Love, the Beatles show in Las Vegas, or recently at the Grammys. He always treats me with kindness and affection. Here are some excerpts of his recollections.
A little later than January.
What is today, April 18th?
About that.
About April 18th.
It's definitely April.
Oh.
The only thing we're sure of, it's April. Somewhere in Los Angeles.
The way I usually do this is I just start and we just run with it and everything is edited later. And if there's anything that I bring up along the way that for some reason or other you don't want to talk about, don't want to answer, you can just suggest that I pass on the question. What we'll do, and you've heard this one before, is just for the benefit of the audience, begin at the very, very beginning, talk a little bit about what it was like back then, and bring us up into the present.
Right. So, hey, you just go ahead. I'll just answer your question.
You've done these before.
I have done several of these interviews.
I've had the experience now of talking with, interviewing John, probably 9 or 10 times, maybe 15 or 20 hours of tape. And I would like to get your recollections of the earliest experiences and see in my own head how they perhaps compared with some of his. Just for the benefit of the audience, there were a couple of things about you that were different from them. You were the last person to join the group. You were the oldest. You came from the roughest part of town. As a child, you were unhealthy.
Not to say the least.
I mean, physically.
Yes.
Let's pick
I'm
up.
I'm not too sure about mentally.
Let's begin with a couple of those points.
Okay.
For the others, growing up in Liverpool.
Do you want my prenatal experience?
No, we won't go back that far. But I want to go back to 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, the roughest part of town, your earliest recollections of Liverpool.
Well, it's my first recollection is 5, when we moved house. We moved just over the road. People in Liverpool don't move very far, you know. But we had a 6-roomed house, and we moved to a 4-roomed house. And that was the first real recollection I can remember. I mean, I was born the day war broke out. But I don't remember all the bombs, though they did actually break up Liverpool, you know. I mean, I remember when I was a little older, there's big gaps in all the streets, you know, where houses used to be. And we used to play on them in the air raid shells. But I don't actually remember any of the bzzz, boom, you know. So 5 is the first one. I sat on the back of this furniture van and just went I don't know, 300 yards up the road to the next street.
Do you remember the name of the street?
Yes, Madron Street was the one we lived in, and then we moved to a street called Admiral Grove.
Who'd you live with then?
My mother. My father sort of decided to leave when I was three, so it was just my mother and I, and that was six rooms. It was very big, and the rent was expensive. So we moved into a great house, which was condemned 10 years before we moved in.
Really?
And it's still there now with people in it. You know, because when we moved, well, I moved my mother out in sort of 63, something like that, 64, when I was making some bread. And my uncle moved in there, and he's only just left, and this is, he left last year, 75, but it was condemned 10 years before we moved in, which is 45.
You were, by all general standards, even Liverpool standards, poor.
Yes. Working class poor. I mean, my mother had to go to work, but she fed me.
What'd she do?
She did everything. She scrubbed steps, she was a barmaid, she worked in a fruit shop. She did everything she had to earn a living, you know.
And what about school? What were the earliest recollections of school? Did you enjoy it? Were you any good at it?
No, I don't remember ever enjoying school. The only great con I had, which I'm not sure if I remember this or my mother's told me it so many times, you know, those childhood stories that they keep telling you, you know, oh, remember the day, was the first day at school. Supposedly I came home at lunchtime, because it was only up the road, you know, it was 3-4 minutes walk. I came home at lunchtime and said, we've got a holiday.
Just announced.
And she believed me, and then she saw all the kids going past the window, you know. Said, get out of here, get back to school. But I nearly conned her. That was the first time at five. But I never liked it. I always sagged.
How long were you in school?
About 5 years in all.
That's the total amount of your education?
Yes.
I read somewhere that much later on in the chronology of this, somebody went back to your school to look for records as to whether or not you were there.
That was me.
You went back to, and they didn't.
No, I was. You see, if we, well, we'll get up to that.
Yeah.
At 6 and a half, I was very ill with peritonitis. So I went from 5 to 6 and a bit. So I did a year and a bit, right? Then I was ill. They thought it was appendicitis. They rushed me to the hospital. It was too late. It was appendix. It exploded. And that's a heavy operation. And it was heavier then, you know. Operations are getting easier as the years roll by. So, excuse me. I was in hospital for a year then. And then it's convalescent and all that. So I didn't go back for 2 years, you know. And after that, I think that's when I really started to hate it. I know I didn't like it before I went to hospital. But then, because you never caught up with the class, you know, mm-hmm. there was no teacher going to take special care of me. You were in the class, and this is it, folks, we're off. And you had to try and get yourself up there, you know, and I always found it very hard, so it was easier to stay off. So I wouldn't, you know, my mother would pack me off to school, and I'd just go and walk around the park with a couple of guys or whatever, and write little notes, and we always got caught because we couldn't spell.
Was the curriculum in your school when you were 5 or 6, in the 5th or 6th grade, similar to what somebody in America at age 5, 6, or 7 may have been?
Well, 5, 6 is mainly playtime and painting and learning to read, you know, cat and stuff like that, and showing your letters. They don't expect too much of you at 5. Nowadays, I mean, just with my kids, I mean, mine could read before they went to school, and then they went to kindergarten school, you know, and we took an interest. I mean, I'm not putting my mother down. She had to go to work, but it would have been better. I mean, I had a girl who used to look after me who taught me to read, which was a friend of my mother's daughter. She was a couple of years older than me, and she used to mind me when your mum went to the pub, you know, or with pictures or whatever they went, if they went out at night. And she taught me to read. I didn't learn to read till I was 9.
And write?
No, I didn't learn to write. I mean, it all came together, really. You know, I'm still not a great writer.
When you think back to the fact that you missed what would be considered the simplest and most basic of education, some people regret that they never went on to college, and some people regret that they never finished high school.
I do now.
You do?
Because your knowledge is so limited, you know? I mean, just your basic school knowledge, you know? You know, 1066, and you know, I never took the Latin. John took the Latin and the painting.
Could you conceive of a time ever when you would return to school?
No.
To study anything?
No, not now. No, I mean, I have the... I'm intelligent, but uneducated.
Just out of curiosity, what was the last book that you read that impressed you, that meant anything to you?
Dahlgren. It's a science fiction book.
Do you read often?
I read all the time. I mean, I can read anything, you know? Even big words like dog.
I don't mean to.
No, I can. I mean, I can read anything. The problem I have is spelling, and usually on the small words, especially the English language for spelling is crazy. You know, there's so many, like wood. You know, would, would you, would we? Yeah, right. You know, all those. So I've never got them together. It's all W, O U L D to me, or W double O D. You know.
We're now in Liverpool. It's mid-1940s, late-1940s. It was tough. I mean, when John or Paul or George reminisce, they talk about a time when things were difficult for them, gangs and teddy boys.
Yes, it was difficult for them because they were never in them. I was always in them.
You were a gang member.
Yeah. You had to be where I lived.
Tell me about that. Tell me what gang you were in, how you got initiated.
Well, okay, we'll skip all this. So I went to hospital. I came out.
I got into school.
That was okay. Then at 13, I got pleurisy, and then that turned into TB, so they put me away for another year. So I never went back to school after 13. That was the thing about we were talking about before,
right.
You have to go and get your form to say you finished school so you can pick up money from the government, you know, till they get you a job. You know, a school leaver, they have to go to this building, the big official says, where's your dismissal from school? And so I went to the school and I said, excuse me, can I have this piece of paper? I don't even know what to call now. You know, to say I'm actually 15 and I was at this school. And they said, they went through the, you never came to this school. I said, honestly, I came to this school. No, you're not in the record. So they found me in the end because, you know, they were looking just the last year. They didn't go back 2 years, you know, to 13. So they found it in the end. Which was the point is they had no recollection of me ever being at that school. Mm-hmm. Then suddenly, when we made it in the Beatles, they had my desk in the garden, you know, for the school garden parties, and they were charging the money to sit on it, you know. So that was always a great joke. Yeah.
The time that you were in the hospital, all the times you were in the hospital, there was one period of time where you were, I'm told, you were virtually unconscious for close to a year.
6 months. Well, that was the stomach one. That was very dangerous. I was sick, man. They told my mother three times I'd be dead in the morning. And that was heavy for her, so I realized why she's so possessive. But I was ill, yeah.
Pleurisy, TB, appendix.
Yeah, peritonitis.
The 6 months...
Never broken a bone, though.
the 6 month period when you were unconscious...
Well, the longest one stretch, I mean, you weren't out for 6 months. 6 months, and I could have come home in a couple of weeks. You know, I was really getting better. And I had a birthday in hospital, and I had this little toy bus. And I was in a cot, you know, with the sides on. And the kid in the... Oh, well, I'll tell this one first. The kid in the next bed wanted to see the bus, you know. So, here. And so I leaned right off, and it's about 4 foot off the ground. But I leaned too far and came right out and ripped all this... You know, the surgery opened. That was the dangerous time. So they put me in for another 6 months. Which one was I going to say? Oh, and at that time, because I was in a cot, I could pick anything up with my feet. Pennies, bits of paper, anything that fell off the cot. You'd get your foot on it. Got it. I got very good feet for picking things up, folks.
Did you ever feel like you were going to die? Were you ever conscious of
that? No. No, and now I refuse. I believe I'll be here till I'm 87, whatever happens. I think planes don't bother me, trains, nothing like that bothers me. I'm just going to be here till I'm 87. I just feel that. I don't know why.
Probably
in a wheelchair from when I'm 39.
No, you're going to go on beyond all of us. When did you join the first gang? What was the name of the gang?
They weren't names. The leaders of the gang. There was like Clem Martindale. There was... guy Tony ran this gang. I mean, they were all just names, you know. We were like the Dingle Gang, you know. That's because of the area.
The Dingle Gang?
Yeah, because I came from Dingle, you see, that was the area. But there were several gangs in that area. But so you'd, the name of the guys who they used to call walk with, you know, you'd walk in en masse to try and cause trouble. And then it'd be into area fights.
In America, when that was going on, when there were gangs in where I grew up in New York City, they really hurt people. They killed
yes.
people, they robbed stores, they burned buildings.
Yeah, yeah, that actually went down. And knifing people, you know. I didn't actually knife anyone or kill anybody.
Did you ever
I got
anybody?
Beaten up a few times. You know. Mainly by the people you were with, you know, because it's that terrible craziness in that gang situation where if you're not fighting an outsider, you get crazy and you start fighting amongst yourselves, mm-hmm. like mad dogs in a way, you know. And you have the outfits. And there's a lot of companies. Well, a big long jacket. Teddy boy suits, we call them. I think you call them zoot suits.
Zoot suits.
You know, tight, very tight trousers, big crepe sole shoes, heavy belt, which I put washers on them, you know, heavy washers, and you'd have them ground down so they, and the buckle would be ground down so it would hurt. And people would have razor blades behind their lapels in case you got grabbed. Mm-hmm. Then the person would mm-hmm. chop the fingers off, you know, and in the cap. And there was a lot of heavy.
So it's important
nasty.
For us to know that this wasn't like a little dress-up costume party.
This was deadly serious because that's what life was about, you know. That you were in the gang, and it was like you were safe in our area. You had to be in one. It was like, you know, if you weren't, you laid your life on hands because you weren't protected or beaten up by, you know, you'd be beaten up by everybody. You know, they had a terrible thing in Liverpool where you'd walk past someone and say, you looking at me? And if you said no, they'd say, why not? So you couldn't win.
You
if you said yeah, then they'd get you anyway. I mean, there was no answer to that question. You're looking at me.
I know you were in it for self-preservation, but was there ever a time when you said to yourself, I just got to get out of here?
I said that as soon as I started playing. And there was a friend of mine, Roy, who's probably still my only friend left in Liverpool.
His name?
Roy Trafford. Telephone. Right, so...
Gang stuff when you...
When we... yes, I wanted to get out of it when I started playing. And we started playing, like, skiffle band, you know. We used to play in the cellar. I used to work in a factory. We'll get to that. We used to play for the men in the lunchtime down the cellar. And when I started playing, I started gradually moving out of walking with the lads, as it was called. You know, that's all you'd do. You'd walk up and down roads, you know, stand on corners, beat someone up, get beaten up, have a fight, go to the pictures, break it up. I mean, you know, it gets boring after a while. You've been that road, you know. So... we decided, you know, we were gradually cutting out and we'd play, so we'd have an excuse not, you know, when we started getting little gigs, you know, mainly auditions for the first year, that's all you ever get, it's a free show. And I remember one night, we went to pictures, and we came out, and there was this whole gang getting it together, and the people we knew, you know, and they said, we're going down to this other area, Garston, to, you know, sort it out. So... You had a decision then. You could say, I'm not going, and they would beat you up anyway. Mm-hmm. Or you went and took your chance, you know. So we went. But then we phased it out and phased it out. And that's how I got out of it.
About how old were you?
When I finally got out? 19, 20.
It occupied maybe 10 years of your life.
No. 15-year kid, and but you know the lads. You really start getting into it 16. It's about 4 years, 3 or 4 years.
You said it was a skiffle band.
Yeah, there
was a skiffle band.
Well, in England, in sort of 58, this big craze came out called skiffle, which was based on like American bottle parties, like blues bottle parties, you know, where you'd take a washboard into mm-hmm. the house and a bottle of beer, it'd be open house, and I believe some people used to like pay a quarter or a dime, it would pay the rent parties. And so you'd have someone with a jug and a washboard and a tea chest base, you know, or an oiled one with a stick and a string, and mm-hmm. someone would have a guitar. Yeah. It'd be like made-up instruments, you know. So that's how I started in one of those. I mean, I had the drums. And
that was the first thing you went to?
The very first, yeah.
Why?
Because you didn't have to be able to play. Because no one could play in those days. They had this Lonnie Donegan and the Vipers and people like that were skiffle groups in England. And it was this sort of house music, you know? And so I got a kit of drums on Boxing Day, I was in a group in February. I mean, no chance in hell could I play by then. But neither could anyone else, bar the guitarist who always knew a couple of chords. Everyone else was making it up.
The first time you sat down behind a set of drums, started doing it. What were there skiffle songs? Were there?
Yeah, there was Hey Lily, you know.
Hey Lily, Lily,
Lily Low. Right. Rock Island Line was a mighty good road. You know, all those type of things.
Early American country and western is, or early American bluegrass.
Yeah,
early American
sort
folk.
Of country folk blues. You know, if you can dig that.
That's the kind of stuff that was you were hearing over the radio, I would assume, also.
Yes, because suddenly there was a great rave for it in England, you know, of this skiffle music. That's what started it in England, every town, and in Liverpool. Then it progressed. I remember being thrown off. There used to be traditional jazz, and then the group would do the break, the intermission, you know.
The skiffle group.
The skiffle group, because it was cheap. You know, you'd have three or four guys, and half the time you didn't pay them. And if you did, we'd get about $1.50 each a night. That's what we were earning. So you had to get a lot of gigs, you know, to make up $20. So we were all semi-professional then, you know. I was an engineer in the day, and I'd play at night.
I've got to ask you one of those terrible interviewer-type questions, but that have to be inserted here. The moment you sat down the first time to play the drums...
Yeah, well, go on. Say it, start again.
The moment you sat down to play the drums for the first time... Was there any thought in your mind that not only would you become good, but that you would also become great, international, and indeed unforgettable?
Well, I think I thought I'd be everything but unforgettable.
It goes back
a long time, the drums, for me. It was like when I was walking to school, before I went to hospital the second time, there used to be a music store. I used to look in the store just at the drums. You know, they had guitars and banjos and mandolins even in those days, and accordions and things like that. And I always looked, and there was one, just a tom-tom, which was used to freak me out. I used to love this tom-tom. I used to go and look at this tom-tom, you know, every day walking to school and walking back, I'd look at this tom-tom. It was £26 in those days, which was a fortune. The whole kit I bought later on didn't cost that, you know. So... I just wanted to be a drummer anyway, from very early on. There was never any other instrument. I mean, I'm not answering your question, but I'll get to it. And then in hospital, when I was with the TB, I mean, they just put you in a glass house, you know, because Liverpool was very, not the cleanest town in the world, you know, and a lot of TB went on in Liverpool. It was one of those cities that attracted TB. And so I was in hospital, and I used to play on the cupboard next to me with these cotton bobbins, big long bobbins, and I'd always be tapping. It just seemed to be my thing. Then I made a kit out of biscuit tins, you know, and then I bought a bass drum. The first drum I ever had was just this, it cost $4, this monster old bass drum with one skin. So when we'd have a party at our house, you know, and we'd have the man from over there would play his banjo, someone else would play harmonica or something, there'd always be a sing-song. There were always sing-song parties, you know, more than records.
Sing
in those days, yeah, everyone sang a song, you know, and it'd all be, you know, oh, I do like to be beside a seaside, you know, it'd be all those songs. So I'd get me drum out, and of course they'd say, oh, it's the kid, you know, they'd let your abba go, you know, here comes the kid with his drum kit, look out. So I was 15, and so I'd bang this thing with two pieces of firewood for a while, then they'd get rid of me, okay, get him off, and they'd send me out, you know, get rid of the drum. So I got rid of that. And then a friend of my father, or my stepfather, Harry, in Romford, he was selling this kit for £10, man. I don't know what that was.
$25.
$25, and it was $30 in those days, real expensive. So he went down to visit his folks for Christmas, and then he came back with this kit, which was amazing. There's drums. There was, you know, not a drum. There was drums. There was a snare and a bass drum and a hi-hat and one little tom-tom.
Cymbal.
And a top cymbal, right? And a bass drum pedal. You don't have to kick it anymore. You know? So, I mean...
That's what you do if you don't have a pedal. You have to kick
the drum. So I set it off in my bedroom, you know, the back bedroom. Set it all off. Yeah. So off I go. Back. Boom! You know, load of crap. so you'd hear from the bottom of the stairs, "Keep the noise down, the neighbours are complaining." So I only ever did it twice, and I got shouted at both times, because, you know, it was a lot of noise, especially when you can't play. It's not, you know, drums aren't that musical the best of times for playing melodies, you know. But it wasn't like a great solo, you know, with something interesting. It was just this mad thing hitting drums. So I never practiced. You know, I stopped it then, and I got into a band. It was the only way I could practice, was to join a group. So I practiced with every group in Liverpool. And I've done that ever since. I've never sat in a room and played the drums. Like, there's this kit here. I've just bought this. It's an old kit. And I just had it done up, but I'll never hit it while it's sitting here. I'll do it in the studio now.
Could you name some of those early groups? We researched that stuff.
Besides the Darktown Skiffle group, the Eddie Clayton Skiffle group, I would play with most bands around. I was well known in Liverpool, you know, just... We all knew each other, so if someone was sick, you'd play, you know. If someone didn't turn up, you'd play. So I played with a lot of bands in Skiffle. Then I got with Rory. I auditioned for Rory, which is interesting, because him and later on the Beatles thought the same thing. When I auditioned for Rory, of course, I was still in my black drape and my hair back, and how are you doing, looking a bit rough, you know. So they were a bit insecure about me, but I auditioned for him, and so I got the job. Because I was a good player. And when I went with Rory, then we were playing rock and roll, and we played the Cavern with Rory. We were the first group to play rock and roll, then we got thrown off the Cavern. Because our lead guitarist had a radio he used to shove his, plug his guitar into. It was the first amp around. It was a radio. I mean, you know, it's rough days in those days.
You were the first rock group to play the Cavern.
Yeah. Which one? Rory was.
Rory was, yeah.
When I was with Rory, the Beatles were nothing. They weren't even formed, you know. And later on, when we went professional, as it were, I stopped work at 20 and went to Butlin's Holiday Camp to play in the Rock and Calypso, they called it, for £20 a week, $50 a week. But it was professional, so I gave up the job and went professional. But when we were getting ready to go, and we had the suits and everything, the shoes to match, you know, we used to do all that stuff. No, it was shoes in those days, black and white shoes, and red suits, red ties. And great, and a hanky to match, you know, all that stuff. Like the bands here used to be, they all used to be in uniforms, you know, in the early rock days. And we went, there was a club there, a coffee bar. We went down for coffee. And downstairs, they used to, usually every night they had a steel band. But we went down this afternoon, and there was John and Paul, and they were teaching Stuart Sutcliffe how to play bass. So that's how loose it was for them. I mean, we were the professionals, and they were just the boys, you know, this struggling artists in those days. And so we went away to play, and we'd come back to Liverpool. And then while we were doing this, because we did it for 2 years, then we went to Germany. And that's where I met the Beatles. Mm-hmm. And that's why it ties up with Rory. We played one club and they were playing in another club. And we knew them, hello, that's all. We didn't, you know them. It was just, oh, hi, you know, from Liverpool, in a bit, hi. So I used to get drunk. And I like sad songs when I'm drunk, you know. That's why I like country, I think. So I'd go into the club. If it ended up that we both played the same club in Germany, the Beatles and Rory. So besides one night, we smashed up the stage between us because it was a heavy competition. There'd be a lot of rivalry going on. I'd end up, if they had the last set, I'd be sitting there saying, you know, play so-and-so, which is like this slow songs all the time.
Melancholy, baby.
I only found this out later. They were always worried about me because here I am in my black drape again and my hair up, you know, and looking crazy. So they went through the same scene they're saying. You know, John will tell you that story. God, we didn't know what was happening. You know, just sitting there asking for these sad songs. Really looked hard, you know, at the sideboards and that. Because I don't particularly think I've got a hard-looking face, but, you know, they used to be a bit worried about it. So they'd play for me.
They'd play it,
mate. Yeah, I want a slow song, brother.
And what kind of stuff
Now you've put me on the spot, I can't think of one of them.
Because when people get drunk,
it was in their repertoire. Yeah, oh, they knew the songs, you know. It was one great one of Elvis's that was really slow that they used to do.
Fool Such As I, that kind of stuff.
I don't think they ever did, though. Well, it's that sort of stuff, right?
Yeah.
So, and I, that's what it is, and they were all a bit worried, so... Then when we got back to Liverpool, I was just in bed one afternoon, you know, because we were up all night, like we are now, and sleep all day. Brian Epstein came up, he says, will you sit in with the Beatles, Peters and Well, you know?
Pete Best.
Yeah, so I said, yeah, okay. So I got up and he had his big car, drove me down there, and I played that afternoon, then they had a show at Southport that evening, so... We played the afternoon session. We went to this Crocodile Club, something like that it was called. Stayed there all afternoon, getting crazy. Well, mainly just drinking those days. And then we drove off to Southport and did the show, and it was very nice. Here's your money, you know. But we got to know each other a bit, because when you're playing, it's different getting to know people from getting to know shaking hands and sitting with them. So then every time Pete sort of wasn't well, I can't say too much, he in those days used to sue me when I said he was sick. You know, I'd sit in, and then gradually we formed this like friendship, and then I was away. I mean, we talked about me joining vaguely, you know, but it was like, well, would you like to? Yeah, I'd like to. They were the only band I'd go and watch, you know, in Liverpool. In fact, we all used to play the same place, though. There's four bands on the bill. They were on the bill. I was on the bill, you know, with my band. Someone else, but I'd just go and watch them because they were the best band in Liverpool. I'd love to get in, and I played with them, and it was always great to play with them, you know. So I'd love to get in this band. So it was, we would, you know, sit in some club somewhere, talk about it. I say, well, you know, if we get it together, I'd love it, you know. So then I got this call from Brian, and we were playing at this holiday company, and he called Tuesday or Wednesday. He says, right, we'd like you to join the group. Can you come tonight? I said, no, I can't do that. I can't leave this band, you know. I mean, without a drummer, they'd lose the gig. They got another 6 weeks to go on the gig, so you couldn't just leave. So I said, no, I'll be there Saturday. And I arrived Saturday, and that's when the riot started, because in Liverpool it was fine while I sat in, because Pete had a good following, you know. He looked like Jeff Chandler in a fit. Sorry, Keith.
Jeff Chandler?
Yeah, he was a bit Jeff Chandler, you know, broad and moody, this big hair thing. So he was the Jeff Chandler of Liverpool, anyway. And but when I got up that night, when I joined, there were riots.
This is the very first night.
Yeah, when I would join the band.
Right.
When I gigged with the band, it was fine.
But
when I joined,
that I joined,
Pete's out the band. So it was big news in Liverpool. You don't imagine how big they were in Liverpool then. Not the world, but just Liverpool was like the world. You know, it was like a monstro move of a lifetime. You know, how dare they? What? Throw Pete out. But it was because I was well known there. Half of the audience were for me. There was two chants going up: Pete forever, Ringo never. You know, Ringo forever, Pete never. So there was these chants going. We're trying to play, you know, it's all this stuff going on. And then George got a black eye. Some guy punched him because I joined the band. You know, can you imagine someone punching him because I joined? You know, you let him in the group. Boom. So, and he was the main instigator anyway, George, for getting me in because he liked me playing. He's not a bad guitarist either.
It's important. I just want to underline this point because it's something that we've covered in interviews with John and George. That when I talked to John about the fame later on, he would always say to me, "You've got to understand that we were famous when we were in Liverpool. That was the microcosm of the experience." What happened later was an extrapolation of...
got bigger, that's all.
But that the real experience, the phenomena that became the Beatles, the first night that you were playing drums, was the whole trip.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I was saying. That was so big. I mean, you had such craziness going on over this band in Liverpool. It was like the Queen had committed suicide, you know? I mean, you know, you can imagine how big that would be. Well, just in Liverpool, which was our world then, it was so big. I mean, you know, it was all we did was get more countries. You know, we never got any sort of bigger, you know what I'm trying to say?
It was complete then.
The rest
of the world would just get wind of what was going on.
Right, but it just got, the situation was in Liverpool. The being big, or, you know, big and famous was in Liverpool. All it did, suddenly got England, then it got Europe, then it got America, then it was like the world, you know, but it was the same experience, just being expanded all the time. The little atom was Liverpool, you know, then we started expanding.
When the four of you were on the stage that night and you were playing the first gig, In your ear, did it sound like you were doing something revolutionary, something extraordinarily different, something unusual, something phenomenal?
No. What was the It just felt great. I didn't think it was revolutionary or, you know, anything like that. It just was a great band to be in, and it was a good time playing in that band.
Would you play that?
We were doing a lot of songs that no one else was doing, but I don't think I ever thought, well, we're doing such a move on the other side compared to anyone else. We were just doing a lot of different stuff. And also, they were writing then, and that was really freaky in those days, you know, doing the songs that the band had actually written. We didn't do, maybe we did about two or three at the most in those days.
What were the songs you were doing then, before there were Lennon McCartney compositions? What were the early...
I don't know, I'd have to look for an old list. We were doing A Shot of Rhythm and Blues, Henry VIII, I Am. I was doing Boys, even doing Till There Was You in those days. Mm-hmm. Long Tall Sally. You Better Move On. Did we do A Better Move On? One of those, there were so many. Chains, but you know, just mainly for England, they were semi-obscure records, you know. Even when we went out of Liverpool, you know, to the down south, more or less, not to London, but you know, the crazy places mm-hmm. between Liverpool and London, like there is between here and New York, they used to laugh at us. They couldn't understand this stomping music and these weird songs, you know, Shot of Rhythm and Blues and stuff, because they were used to Cliff and the Shadows and these other sort of, this other type of music, you know. And we came out there, and I remember audiences would laugh at us. They thought we were a joke. But they got into it fast enough.
You went from Liverpool on to Hamburg. You went to Hamburg primarily because that's where the bread was. And the bread was mainly in the hands of American GIs, American sailors, in Europe for the first time, spending American bucks.
Well, I don't know. We got it from the club owner.
He got it from
the... You know, the people used to buy your drinks, that's all. We never used to get tips in money, you know, when we were playing, if that's what you're saying. There was a lot of money in Germany, and therefore the club was always... mainly Germans. You know, there wasn't such a big scene with American, or in England in those days, had a lot of soldiers there. They'd come in occasionally, and boats, you know, to ports or sailors would come in. But the majority of the audience was young, from sort of 15 to 25 Hamburgians, whatever they're called.
You went from Hamburg back and forth Hamburg and Liverpool and on. And then there was the night that it was suggested that it was time to do the first album.
Well, it wasn't suggested. Brian had begged for months. I mean, he begged before I joined. They'd done these demos, which he took around. And, you know, he'd been begging. Then I joined, and he was still begging. And then suddenly he found Dick James, who turned him on to George Martin, who'd give us a chance, you know. He would do a record, he listened to the tapes, and he thought they had something. I don't think he liked Peters, the drummer, which is no offence, because when I got down there, he had another drummer, and he didn't like me either. Mm-hmm. So, but he sort of liked what they did. Then they tried to get us to do someone else's song. And mainly John and Paul were adamant that they wanted to do their own song. I mean, I wasn't even going to play on the session, but I would have preferred to mime to one of their songs than one of ours, or learn it later to play on stage, you know. And so they held out. Well, we all held out in the way, but they held out the more, because they were running the band then. And so we did Love Me Do, which was their song. And this guy, Andy White, is on the single, and I'm on the album, because I did it on the album. It was not hard to play. But I think we freaked George out, because we did this like audition of about seven or eight numbers before we recorded, and we did Please Please Me, and I was playing the bass drum, the hi-hat, a tambourine, a maraca. I had a tambourine in one and a maraca in another, and I was hitting the cymbals as well. So he thought, oh, there's some crazy man here. So he thought it was just some sort of weird leper, you know, spastic leper or something, trying to play all these instruments at once. within the track, so he decided to get a professional drummer in, you know, for the date, because we don't know what this man's going to do. I don't know what went through. I've never talked to him about it. We've kidded about it, but I've never seriously asked him what did he think was happening.
Great to get his impression.
When I came down with this handful of junk, you know, playing all these things and hitting the cymbal with a maraca, you know. Now I can see him. Oh dear, let's get out of here. So, and then from then on, of course, I played with the band. But, and the first session, the first record, Love Me Do, for me, I don't know if you've asked John and George, and you'll tell me later. That was more important than anything else. That first piece of plastic, you don't believe how great that was. And it got to, you know, 206 in the charts or something. And it did nothing here. Three records did nothing here. But it would move. It got to 54, something like that. And they all thought we were buying it in Liverpool, because the whole of Liverpool went out and bought it en masse, you know. You know, not just the kids, everyone, because they were proud, a group from Liverpool, you
their
know.
Own boys.
It was fantastic, you know. There's a lot of that in Liverpool. They're very close. So every time this record moved the place, we'd have a dinner. We'd have a big celebration dinner, you know. We were getting 25, 30 quid a week then, but prior to, we go off for dinner, yeah. And we all got very fat. But it was exciting. That and the first number one.
Which was?
Please Please Me. Yeah. Went to number one, and we had three numbers. We were doing a tour with a girl called Helen Shapiro, and we were opening the bill for her. And suddenly the crowds were coming in. We'd do three numbers and they'd all leave. And she was starting to freak out. And we had a good time. And then, of course, next time we were top of the bill. But
you talk with great excitement about the first disc.
Oh, I do. It was marvellous. I mean, it was so wonderful. Piece of plastic. I mean, look at your name on it. Parlophone. I mean, Parlophone I wasn't too pleased with. It was like the worst label you could be on. But shit, we were on a record, you know. That's great excitement to me.
You remember the first time you heard it on the radio?
We were in a car.
All of you?
Several of us. We were always together. We were in a car. No, is that the... I think we were in a car in Soho is one recollection. I don't... Because, you know, you've got to imagine every time it was played or moved a spot, we had a lunch. This thing went on for 6 months, man. Even if it went down, we'd celebrate. moved anyway. Yeah, let's have dinner. I think we did a show. EMI used to buy time on Luxembourg. Mm-hmm. And we went down and mimed to it. They used to have like 50 kids in this like room, but it was a live sort of disco radio show. And I think that's the first time it was ever on radio.
Radio Luxembourg.
Radio Luxembourg, yeah.
You recall the show? Because those shows had names and special hosts.
No, it was like EMI show, I don't know. In those days, Decca would have, you know, 10 hours a week. EMI had 10 hours a week. Philips would have so many hours. It's not like that now, but record companies would buy time and put shows on and just play their records.
That led to the first album. The album known in America is Introducing the Beatles.
Yeah.
And the album that...
Well, the first album, I mean, after the single, and we were touring and playing clubs, you know, dance halls. We were playing anywhere because, you know, Brian was booking us up, and even when we had the number one, we were still playing dates we'd committed to. Even the second number one, we were still playing sort of ballrooms because we'd committed to it before we'd made it, you know, because you'd say, January, you'd book us for November somewhere, you know, you get a date. So we fulfilled all our commitments. Even didn't matter how many number ones we had, we suddenly end up, you know, from touring top of the bill with Roy Orbison and Trini Lopez or someone like that, we'd be playing this little jive arse dance hall, you know. But it was good fun. Because it was booked. We didn't cancel anything, you know, like a lot of bands do now. Suddenly they're making the, no, I'm not doing that anymore, which I think is silly. Because it's good in that transition period to not only do the big halls, but to keep getting back to where you've just come from. And you can relax more, you know, the excitement on the stage.
You mentioned two names that you were touring with now. You were Roy Orbison and Trini Lopez. Now,
Chris Montez.
Ah, Chris Montez. You didn't tour with Trini Lopez.
No, we played with Trini in Paris.
And is this when he first had his hits with Lemon Tree?
If I had a hammer, ding, ding, I sing it in the morning,
the
ding,
Peter, Paul,
ding.
And Mary repertoire.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're now talking about 1961, if my recollection.
No, I didn't join until 62.
So we're talking about 62.
Yeah, you see, he may have done all those records here in 60, 61, but it always took records a year to get over there, you know.
when
mind you, I had a hammer. He probably did that a year before we played it with him, but that was always Tweeney's biggie for me. If I had a hammer, all a hammer around here, Tweeney.
Roy Orbison and Tweeney Lopez. Any other names come to mind?
Tommy Rowe.
Yeah.
Tommy Rowe. English ex, Mac Monroe, Kenny Lynch. The first one was Helen Shapiro.
Would we know her here? Excuse me, Helen, I don't
know. No. She was about 1960. She had a few hits. One doesn't come to mind I can think of.
You did the album, the first album.
Well, that's what I was getting to. We were doing all this playing all over the road, you know. And they said, well, you can do an album now. So we went in and we did the album in 12 hours. Because we did everything we've been doing on the road for the last year or so, you know.
The entire album, one 12-hour
Yeah, and Twist and Shout was the last one, and John really does it well, but he broke his throat doing it. You know, because it was the last one. And everyone just let it out, you know. So we did it in 12 hours. But it was easy because we'd done them, you know. We'd done them for years.
That album was released, and to say that the rest was history is...
It's simple.
It's simple and true.
Right.
And it was. And after that, you were to become the most famous group in the history of the world and sell more records than any other group before or since.
Yeah.
Did you know at that time, when the album came out and when you heard that it was being played in America, I mean, at that point, you must have had some
idea. Had a thing, where are we going? To the top, Johnny. We had a thing. I mean, you see, it went in stages. I mean, I can't answer that question. You know, we did the first record. I mean, you thought, God, we're going to be big. I don't think I ever... no one can conceive, you know, that we were going to be as big as we were. My tiny brain wouldn't acknowledge it. I mean, I wanted to play the Palladium. That was big. Then we did the Palladium. Oh, that was over with. And then we did Europe, and that was great. And then America was freaky because, I mean... It's been in every magazine, radio show in the world. The story about George came to America to visit his sister and went round the shop saying, have you got any Beatle records?
1963.
You know, and they're saying, what? Get out of here. What are they, insects? All that crap, you know. So, and he came back. Because we did. We had three records out here. Did nothing. We had one. No, we had two. One on Swan and one on VJ. And we did nothing. Mm-hmm. Of course, they did it. After we did, I think I Want to Hold You, whichever was the big one here.
Yeah.
And he came back to me and said, oh God, they don't know us, we're going to die, you know, it's going to be such a battle. Because we were used to, by then, of going places and being known, you know. So we didn't have to pull the audience, they just came anyway, you know. We didn't have to do any crazy tricks to pull the audience in. They just came to see these loonies from Liverpool, who were monsters in England, and then, consequently, all over Europe. So we'd go anywhere in Europe or England and... We'd have a full house. So we thought, well, yeah, but we go to America. Because the name of the game is to make it in America. It still is. That's the game in music. Doesn't matter if you're big in England, like Slade or Gary Glitter, all that.
Mm-hmm.
They want to make it here. They want to make it here, you know. America is the place because...
Why?
It's still the record. It's still Hollywood of the records, you know. It's still the movie capital. I don't care what they're saying. It's not the capital. It's still all the movie stars are here. You know, and it's the same with records. America's the place to do it. So, just by luck, I mean, I don't know, I always think there's five of us four and someone up there, you know,
yeah.
Or out there, or in here, wherever. Why we were booked on the Sullivan Show was because we came in from Sweden. It's only over the road from England, you know, like going next door. And we came in, there was about 10,000 kids around the airport waving us in. We'd only been away 2 days. And Ed Sullivan came in from New York at the same time, and he saw all these kids, you know, for whatever they say about Ed, he was bright enough to say, well, something's going on here. And he booked us for two TV shows, one in New York and one in Miami, for $10,000. It was $5,000 apiece. And just a little bit of knowledge, folks. We weren't always, you know, loaded. but we came, and we'd signed up to do the Ed Sullivan Show whenever it was. It was in the winter, I think. Remember having my overcoat on. And from the signing to when we should have done it, we'd signed with Capitol in America, and we'd made them promised they'd promote us, because the other record companies didn't promote, just put the records on. You need promotion even to this day. You've got to get it out there, you know. So they swore they'd spend a small fortune. They spent, I think, $250,000 on promotion, which worked. And so the record took off, right? So the day we arrive, we're number one. So we get to America, and what's this? There's 20 billion kids out there again. It's just, wow, it's fitting into place all the time, you know. We did the Sullivan Show, and that's, you know, where it goes from there. It just went on and on. We'd conquered America, folks.
A lot of people recall where they were the day that President Kennedy was assassinated.
Yeah, and that was in a film, Night Moves, the other night. And for the life of me, I can't think.
Well,
I think, that was the Bay of Pigs one. I remember that more than him being shot. We were in some dressing room, and it was like the war's broken out. And we're sitting there, like, getting ready to go on stage somewhere in England. That was the freakier than him being shot. I can't honestly remember where I was when he was shot.
John said that you were all together in England, and that you were preparing to... The word was out that you were going to hear I Want to Hold Your Hand as being the number one selection in England. And you were all around the radio because they got into number five, number four, number three, number two. And you were there, and you were all ready, and that's when the bulletin came in.
They didn't play our record.
No, they went right to.
You think you would have waited?
It is also interesting to note.
Well, that could be true. I don't know.
That was John's record.
In fact, we were out of our brains.
A lot of people will recollect or remember where they were then, and a lot of people in America and perhaps around the world will remember where they. Well, certainly in America, will remember where they were when they first saw you on the Ed Sullivan Show. Those were two great media moments that a lot of people can just say, I remember being in the living room and this, that, and the other thing. In fact, when I was living in New York at the time, and this was in... two points I want to make here. One was the fact that a lot of people have indicated that President Kennedy probably never heard the Beatles perform, to give you an idea of how long... Perform or play. Maybe never heard him on record. Give you an idea of how long it's been since he's been gone.
What was he into?
Yeah. I mean,
does anyone know?
It's probably, if he had ever had his radio on in the car, he might, but it's been so long since he's been gone that he never heard the Beatles. In New York City, when you were on your airplane flying from London to the airport, which was then called, before Kennedy, it was, I forgot what it was
LaGuardia.
Called.
No, that's the other one.
Idlewild. On WINS Radio, the number one radio station in New York at the time.
Murray the K
was giving updates.
10cc wins.
Where they are, how many more miles left. The temperature, I have recordings at home of that. And literally in New York, the city stood still. There were 35, 40, 50,000 people at the airport.
On the aeroplane, I felt New York. It was like an octopus grabbing the plane, you know. There was like, I was just sitting on this plane. I could feel like tentacles coming up to the plane. It was so exciting, you know. And the first time in New York, you know, it was
bedlam.
It was exciting. I mean, we'd pulled big crowds and we'd had big airport reception. But of course, America was bigger than anywhere else in Europe, so therefore the crowds are bigger. So we got off the plane. I mean, we were used to 10,000-12,000 people, you know, and that was a lot. And we got off. Idlewild. I mean, there must have been 4 billion people out there. I mean, it was just crazy. It was fantastic. And we got into all the way we drove through. It was like, you know, the Royal Tour.
Yeah.
This motorcade thing, but there was people lying in the route. Then we got to the hotel and it was madness.
The Plaza Hotel.
Yeah. And they were all outside. There was barriers and horses and cops all over the place. And it was very exciting. It was great.
The New York Police Department now estimated there were 250,000 people that lined the route from the airport to the hotel. It was the first time at the Plaza.
I told you it was more than 10,000.
It was big.
It was big.
Schools were closed down so kids could go out. Traffic stopped in Fifth Avenue, Wall Street. The Stock Exchange closed earlier that day. It was the most incredible single cultural experience that had ever hit anybody under 30.
And we're four of us sitting in the car, giggling. look.
I want that point of view. As all of that was going on outside.
We couldn't believe it. Well, I'll speak for everybody. We couldn't believe it. I mean, I'm looking out that car. What's going on? Look at this. Can you believe this? I mean, that was the dialogue. It was like, shout, you know. It was amazing. And the crowds, you know.
Then the Ed Sullivan Show, then Miami, then back, then a tour.
Well, we did Washington in between.
Washington. And that was weird.
I mean, we got a train there with the press. You know the story about the press. They came to kill us, you know.
Yes.
They came to kill us. And but I mean, I think that's where we were lucky from Liverpool. And we weren't, you know, the pop star image in England, I don't know about here, was like milk drinking, non-smoking.
Yes, Pat Boone.
You know, high. So we get in this press conference, you know, and I, in those days, a scotch and coke and a ciggy, you know, smoking and drinking. And it, so this gang of press, and heavy press, I mean, hard liners came up there, shouting at us. And so we shouted back, because that's how we are, you know, and suddenly they, you know, I mean, you know, it gets, hey, what do you think you do with that haircut, you know, he's like, ah, piss off. And the guy's going, oh, what's going on here? You know, because if it had been, you know, one of the milk drinkers, it'd be, oh, excuse me, sir, I don't like your language, and whatever, you know, I mean, they'd get some dumbass answer. So we just shouted back. And so I only found this out later, you know. But if you look at the footage, you'll see us shouting back. No one's topping me, babe, you know. We'll just get you right back there. Because we always work best when the audience, you know, the press comes, we did all the time, they'd shout at us. And we just get it off. It was, you know, the Marx Brothers again. It didn't matter. If I was tired, the other three would do it. If Paul was tired, the three of us would do it. Well, you know, we'd always take over, you know. If the four of us were bright, we'd all do it. So this thing was going bounce, bounce, bounce. And we only found out later, we'd gotten this train to go to Washington. And the press came too, and I was sitting around with them. And that, they were telling me, they were saying, you know, we came out to kill you, and you were shouting at us, you know, as much as we were shouting at you. And then they got to love us, you know. And that's how it happened. If we'd have stood there, like, shaking, if we'd have been from, say, another city or, you know, another type of band, we would have been destroyed in this country. We'd have been finished, I think. You know, they could have destroyed us. But we just shouted at them. They knew they've got something going now.
Side two, interview with Ringo Starr continued.
Part two.
All right, a lot of the stuff that we could cover right now, a lot of people, everybody knows about.
Yeah.
It just went on, and it was incredible. It was phenomenal. There are a couple of little points along the way that I'd like to talk to you about, and I'd like to talk about the breakup of the group, and then onward to your own life independently of your three companions.
Yes.
Some of the others reminisce about the fact that some of the... John said in one of our interviews, the most recent one, last month, 2 months ago, he said, quote, by the time the Beatles came to America, they couldn't perform live anymore, unquote.
That's the truth.
Your concerts were 15 to 18 minutes on the average.
No. We had 12 songs, roughly just over 25 minutes was our act. And if we didn't like the place, we would do everything fast and get out in 20.
20 is the fastest.
You're up. You'd do them all just a bit up-tempo. Of course, we did them slow some nights if we were tired, and that would go to 31. But that was our act. And he's right. I mean, I can see what he's saying when we couldn't play live anymore. Because of England and Europe, then the start of America, where, I mean, it's the great truth, no one heard us. Not even ourselves. I mean, I found it very hard. I mean, if you look at any footage, I'm looking at amplifiers thinking the sound's going to come through my eyes instead of my ears, but it's like, you know, direct your whole being to this amplifier to pick up something that's going on so I can hear. Because of the noise, because we went out with very small amps and the house PA. I mean, you look at a band now, they're carrying three articulated trucks of equipment putting out 2 billion watts, you know. So... Hello, Spook. That's our cat meowing on your tape, folks. So,
ambient.
We were turned into very bad musicians purely because I couldn't do any fills, because I'm just there going back, back, just to hold it together somehow, you know. So if ever I got off for a fill, which isn't as loud as all your force on an offbeat, it would get lost anyway, and the timing usually went all to cock, you know. Start going crazy because not only trying to get back in on time, but then the guitars would lose what was going on, and so then we'd have like 2 bars to find out where we are again. And he's right, and that's why we were bad players. And so this was going on, and we all knew it, and so it went on and on. Just put it down, thank you. That's when we decided to stop in 66. Everyone thought we toured for years, you know, but we didn't. I joined in 62, and we'd finished touring in 66 to go into the studio where we could air each other and create. any fantasy that came out of anybody's brain.
And that brought us up to Rubber Soul and Revolver.
Well, just one funny trip on the plane. Besides, they couldn't hear us, but sometimes to keep ourselves amused, I'd play Love Me Do like a rumba or something, you know? Which no one ever knew. I mean, we just knew that as a band. We used to do tricks for each other to keep us alive. Sometimes you got very tired. And, you know, the audience, we always love the audience, you know? It's not bullshit. I mean, I love the audience all the time. They were great. And I loved them freaking out. But sometimes, you know, I wanted to have a laugh myself, and I would play it like a rumba or a samba or, you know, something crazy.
How would Love Me Do work as a rumba?
Not very well. You know. So and there was a lot of tricks like that. There was a lot of funny things on the road, you know, touring. I came in with the highest scream in the house one night. And the other three looked at me as if I'd gone insane. And then in Indianapolis, where they have the race.
The Indianapolis Speedway.
Right, so besides driving around there in the police car, the police were always very nice in those days. They weren't pigs. They were very nice. I was driving this cop car around the race course, and we got chased by another cop car. I mean, there was a lot of fun things going on as well. So I happened to have stayed up for 3 days and nights, which is probably the longest I've ever stayed up to this day. It was 3 days and nights. And we got on stage, and I was very slow. To say the least, I was slow. So Paul would go, 1, 2, 3, 4, and I go, you know, what? You know, so, and I'm going, come on, buddy, speed up, no way. And then it frightened me because the bass drum leg went independent. It just started flapping about all over the place, flap, flap, flap. So it frightened me a bit. But, I mean, there was funny things like that. It's funny now. At the time, I freaked out. Oh, God, what's happened to me? You know, just your leg. I mean, if you can imagine your leg just jumping up and down on its own accord, no control. But it was fun on stage. I mean, it's fun to look back on to think I actually went on the stage and with a loose leg. And, you know, they've had their own funniness going on, you know.
We're going to roll in here a bootleg recording of the Hollywood Bowl concert that'll be creeping up under what you're about to tell us. When you played the Hollywood...
Isn't that the Hollywood Bowl contest? Not even contest, concert.
Can you hear it behind us?
Hey, yeah, listen
to
that.
Your earphone?
It's just like I was there, just like yesterday.
When you played the Hollywood Bowl in Los Angeles, which was a major event in California, any specific recollections of that gig, or was it...
Of the gig? No, see, the events were starting to become everything that went around the plane. The plane was something we did. And, it, you know, there was big audiences, and, like, Shea, that was just a massive audience, but on stage was getting to be the fun thing, what we were doing. I mean, if you look at the footage of Shea, where John's like a loony, playing the electric piano or organ with his elbows, and we had to overdub most of it anyway, the sound. When we got to here, I mean, it was amazing. We had this Monstro house, and it was sunshine. And
Bel Air.
Bel Air, yes, right. So, and, you know, meeting Elvis, and then we were around this house.
Tell that story again.
Meeting Elvis?
Yeah.
The first time I met Elvis.
That story always worked.
He was, it was very weird. He was the king, and he turned my head around. I always thank him for being born, you know, because I was into Johnny Ray, which I loved. He always made me cry with Little White Cloud that cried. I was always a crier, Christ. I whinge over anything. Yeah. So then Elvis came out, and he was like the first teenager rock and roller for me. Because Bill Haley, I love Bill Haley, but he was always like your dad, you know? But he played good music. So all the rockers seemed to be a bit like your dad. Elvis was sort of the first teenagers, you know, besides Frankie Lyman that got into all that. But Elvis was the biggie, right?
Yep.
And he was a teenager, and all the great stories where he was, you know, they wouldn't show him on the Sullivan Show below the waist, which was a drag. I went to see him in Vegas and thought he was stiff as a board. But the other one, this great meet, so it's the Fab Four meet Elv. And, you know, we're all a bit nervous. You know, you get a bit edgy, and he probably was a bit edgy. So we go in. He always had these football players with him. I never understood that.
Bodyguards.
Well, no, bodyguards and football. They're always playing football, you know. I said, why isn't he playing music? You know, what's he been playing football again? So we walk in, and he's playing bass to the television.
What was on the television?
Well, I don't know, you know, Dragnet or something. I don't know what was on, some program. It wasn't, you know, a musical show, I remember that. And I I mean, I remember going through this weirdness of, hello, he's playing bass to the television. You know? But it's probably just a way of him getting out of his nervousness. I don't know. But that was always a story that stuck in my mind, not a story, an incident.
Do you remember talking with him at all, the first meeting up in Bel Air?
I don't remember too much of the dialogue. Hi, you know, hello, yeah, it's good to meet you, loved your early records. Colonel Tom gave us a covered wagon that was a lamp.
That was it?
And then we got all Elvis's records. I love Colonel Tom, he's a man you should talk to. He'll tell you stories that'll blow your brain. Which I won't repeat here.
I might just also add that recently, about a year ago, I interviewed Priscilla Presley, Elvis's wife, and she recalls Elvis's point of view of that same meeting, because I asked her what it was like in the house.
Well, then tell me on your tape.
Well, briefly, because you were just living down the block from him in Bel Air. I forgot the name of the street. And the word had come up to the house that the four of you were on your way up, and he was scared to death. He was just... He was not sitting in front of the television playing bass when he got the word, and he just didn't know what to do, where to receive all of you. Mm-hmm. What am I going to say to them? Priscilla said that he was concerned that maybe he wouldn't understand the way you spoke because the accent was...
There we are, Arabs.
So finally when you arrived, it was overwhelming to him, and when you left, he was just a wreck, because to him it was not... four against one isn't fair. You know?
Yes, I was going to say that. We were always lucky because there was four of us. So we always mainly outnumbered anyone we met, you know. So we had each other to rely on, you know, for security blankets around us. What did she say he was playing bass?
Not before you would arrive.
No, he playing bass when I arrived?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
He was. I thought I was going crazy.
No, he was there doing that.
Yeah.
Just before we leave, Elvis.
Did she remember the program? $200, Priscilla. What program was it?
Before we leave, Elvis, if the Beatles were the most phenomenal group in the history of the world, Elvis certainly was the most incredible single act in the history of the world.
Yes, still is.
Do you still have the same reverence for him now? I go to the Hilton and see him in Vegas.
No, I only went once. As I said, he disappointed me. He was great. I mean, it was still, I'm looking at, you know, as people look at us, I'm looking at my myth, you know. Yeah. I'm looking at Elvis. And I don't want to see him again, really. Yeah. No, I've seen him and I've covered it. I never really liked him after sort of 59.
When the movie, after the army.
Well, before the army. When did he go in? 58 he went in the army?
Yeah, when he came out he started doing the
Well, just before he went in he started slowing down. He wasn't a rocker anymore. He was turning into a cabaret act, you know. Yeah. For me personally, you know, I liked all his rock stuff. All his early stuff was amazing. Then he did that first movie, Love Me Tender.
Yeah.
That was great. And then after that, it went downhill. Jailhouse Rock was good. Yeah, so Jailhouse Rock. After Jailhouse Rock, it went downhill for me. So, I don't want to see him again. You know.
Was he the most significant musical force in your life?
No, there was lots. Gene Autry was the most. It may sound like a joke. Go and have a look in my bedroom. It's covered with Gene Autry posters and pictures.
Gene Autry.
He was my first musical influence. He sent shivers down my spine when he put his leg over the horn on the saddle and sang South of the Border, Down Mexico Way, in a movie, right? I'm not putting you on. Honestly, I was.
Because Johnny Ray, I was right with you on The White Cloud That Cried.
Well, I was into it before. I never had records or anything, but I'd go to the movies all the time, right?
Gene Autry on Champions?
On Champion, he sang South of the Border. He had three guys behind him, Mexicans, going, ay, 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 ay. And I was going, oh, look at him. And he's playing. He's got his leg over the horn of the saddle thing. And he's singing this song, man. It freaked me out. It's my first. I don't even know what age I was. Probably 8, it must have been in between hospitals. It was fantastic, and loved it. And that sticks in my brain. My first musical experience was that. I mean, I'd heard music before, but that one is my biggie. Then I got Johnny Ray, you know, and Perry Como's and all them, you know, they were around in sort of 54-ish. But they started about 54, I think. But Bill Haley was out in 54. Well, whenever they were around, Johnny Ray came to Liverpool, which again I can see, I think it helped. I could see why kids were doing what they were doing because we were around. Because I did a lot of them when other people were around. When Johnny Ray played Liverpool, he sat on top of the Adelphi Hotel and waved. And I'm there saying, oh, he's waving at me. Look at that. Hi, Johnny. So, of course, he wasn't. There was like 40 people down there. There wasn't big crowds in those days. And then I saw him in a restaurant in Liverpool, and I always remember it. I'm looking in this window. I think that must have been 55-ish, late 55.
I'll fix up the
dates. Doesn't matter, anyway.
It does.
I mean, they all get mingled, you know. They all get meshed into one. So he's eating in this restaurant. I look in this window, and I honestly, consciously remember going through, he's eating like a real person.
you know,
it's like, oh, yeah, look at that. He's eating. I mean, you know, it just like us, you know. Of course he's like us, but you know, I just remember this flash. And so when people would say, oh, look, you're eating or you're breathing just like a human, you know, I always flashed on me doing it so many years ago, you know, so I could see him doing it, saying, yes, I eat just like everyone else, you know. Sorry to disappoint you.
After the touring, after all of the insanity, the first 10, 15, 20 million records, I Want to Hold Your Hand, the last time I checked in was 6.5 million singles, the largest selling Beatles single.
Do you know how many we've sold altogether?
The last time I checked in, about 2 months ago, was 400 million items.
Really? Last time I checked, it must have been 6 years ago, it was only 250 million.
Oh, it's over 400 million as of last month.
Buy myself a new swimming pool.
You know what the number one album was, by the way?
Ours?
Yeah. That has sold the most to date as of Christmas 1976.
And it isn't Sgt. Pepper?
Nope.
No. Rubber Soul?
Nope.
I have one more guess, right? Late or early?
Late.
Well, if there was any sense in the world, it would be Abbey Road.
It was.
Oh, was it? Because
single largest selling.
So it should be. That's my fave. That.
Is Abbey your favourite Beatle?
The second side of Abbey Road is my favourite. I love it. The bathroom window and all those bits, they weren't songs. I mean, they were just all the bits that John and Paul had around that we roped together, you know. And also, it's a great... I got the kit I still use to this day. And I got skins and got rid of plastic heads, so it's very large in my memory.
And I love that
piece. And the White Album is important to me for different reasons. One, I left the band on the White Album because I couldn't take it. It's a great funny story, right? We're doing this album, and I'm getting weird, right? So, you know, I'm going through crazy head jobs, right? So I'm sitting around, and I've got to leave, right? You know, I'm talking, this is to myself, you know, I'm talking to myself, you know, I've got to leave this band. It's not working, you know? So I go round to John, he's like, you know, knock, knock. I said, John, listen, you know, it's not working. You three are really fine. I feel out of it, you know. I don't feel it's any, you know, I'm any good to the band. And he said, I thought it was you three. I was like, oh, what? So I went, okay. Then I went round to Paul. I mean, I'm still checking it out, right? After he'd said, I thought it was you three, so I go round to Paul. Listen, I'm leaving the band, you know, we're not getting on. You three are really getting it together, and I feel like, you know, I'm out of it, not doing anything. He says, I thought it was you three. So, shit, this is crazy. We're all going through it, are we? So I just said, okay, well, I'm going on holiday, and I went away for 2 weeks, and that's when I left the band. And then I got a telegram from Johnson. Oh, some great drums or whatever, you know, on the tracks we'd done. And they came back, and it was great because George had set up all these flowers all over the studio saying, welcome home, you know. So, and then we got it together again. And the White Album was important also because it was more like a band. Obviously, I never really liked Sgt. Pepper.
You didn't?
I mean, I think it's a fine album, you know. I mean, it is a fine album, and all the work we do is fine, but I think I felt like a session man on it. Because we put so much on it, you know, all the, you know, the strings and the concept and the brass, and you'd sit around the studio for days, you know, while we're overdubbing other things. So I always felt, well, it was better on the White one for me. We were more like a band, a little group, you know, and I enjoyed the group feel. So, I mean, people keep saying, oh, Sgt. Pepper, it's a fine album, but just for me emotionally, I prefer Abbey Road and a lot of the White Album.
You were
and the early albums for different reasons, you know, this was later on.
You are aware of the fact that according to Rolling Stone magazine and the rock critics and the rest of it, Sgt. Pepper is considered the greatest single rock album ever produced.
Yes, I do.
But you do not acknowledge them.
Yes, I do. It is, it's fine, you know, it's a great album. I'm not putting the album down, just... our relationships. You see, you have to think, I don't just look at it, listen to the record. I'm going through what our relationships were at the time, you know, and they changed all the time. And I felt our relationship was better on the White Album and definitely on Abbey Road.
According to George, according to John, it was all over by Let It Be. By the time Let It Be was being filmed and recorded, according to George and according to John, they
it knew was.
That yeah, was it.
That's because George left. George left on Let It Be. We were very possessive of each other, you know. The four of us had been through a lot together, and we were very close most of the time. We weren't close all the time. And it went round, you know, I'd be close with John, I'd be close with George, I'd be close with Paul, they'd be close, John and I and George would be close, Paul, John and George would be, you know, it went round in a lot of circles. But most of the time, four of us were very close. And I don't know, I thought we were very possessive of each other in a way, you know, not like, you know, a mother-son thing, mm-hmm. you know, but just with ourselves. And we didn't like strangers coming in too much. And the wives and the girlfriends never came to the studio. That was where we were together. And I think that's why we worked so well, because there was just the four of us and there was no outside influence, unless we brought it in, like, you know, someone to come down and play on it, or Mick had flash past for an hour or so because he had nothing to do or whatever, you know, those things. But basically it was just the four of us recording, and it was intense, you know, and dramatic, and we were trying to get the record done the best we could. We'd do one track for a week, you know. It takes a week to do one track, just the backing track sometime. So we all got a bit weird, and you know, I was wondering what was happening one day. So I was saying to John, you know, what is going on here? You know, you're always together all the time. You know, you're freaking me out a bit. What's happening? And he told me what they were trying to do. It's nothing to do with you, the listening public. But he told me what they were doing. So then I was fine after that. I thought, oh, well, okay. I mean, that's how he wants to do it. You know, that's fine with me. And then I sort of relaxed a lot around Yoko. I think she's hysterical. I played on an album with her. I think that's one of them. Also, I think the other one is that George was getting a lot of independence for himself in those days, writing more. He wanted things to go his way, where when we first started, they basically went John and Paul's way, you know, because they were the writers. And they'd say, you know, this is the song. I would play as creatively as I could, and they would say, can you do this? But sometimes I'd have three people telling me how to do it, and I'd play it the only way I could, and it seemed to work, you know, because the three frustrated drummers I used to have in my band, or in the band, because they all wanted to play drums, and I couldn't play guitar, so it didn't matter. And I think that really helped me play in a way, because they all... And I kept screaming, there's two drummers, you know, they're saying, play this, like on that track, I'm saying, for Christ's sake, there's two drums there. They could never hear that, you know, they just hear some drum thing going on. And so you'd have to have four arms to do half of the stuff they wanted me to do. So I would do it however I could. Anyway, back to George. And the other reason, I think Paul was... George was finding his independence, and he wouldn't be dominated as much by Paul as he was. Because Paul would, in the end, wanted to, like, point out the solo to George. And George was saying, well, I'm a guitarist, I'll play the solo. And he always did, you know. You know, he always played fine solos for what our band was, you know. Like, I played for what our band was. John's the greatest rhythm guitarist still. And he plays lead in a crazy sort of way. I think that was another factor, because George left with a big row with Paul. Because Paul, like, wanted to point out how to play, because it was his song, you see. I mean, he had sort of a right, but no right at all to do that, you know, to say, I wrote the song. It got a bit like, I wrote the song, I want it this way, where before it was, I want the song, give me what you can give me, you know, which that's how it was earlier on. So, and also, you know, well, we were all married by then, you know, the family, and everyone wanted to do different things, and I wanted to be in movies and stuff. I don't know. And, you know, as I said, with George writing a lot, so how many songs is he going to get? And then I started writing. I used to have one song, you know. Then I wrote two. I would have liked two on, but it would have been a battle, you know, to get two of mine on. Then you, because they, it doesn't matter what I've written today, I still haven't topped Lennon and McCartney. They wrote some fine, fine songs. fine songs, not just because it was I was in the band and I was with them. They have written some incredible things, you know. We've been together so long. We were living our own lives, you know. I think that I couldn't put my finger on one thing why we broke up. It was time, and we were spreading out, you know. Well, they were spreading out more than I was. I would have stayed with the band.
For you personally, at that point, at the Let It Be album point, would you have been willing to give it a couple more years, or were you about ready to move on?
Well, it would have had to sorted itself out. As it was, I wouldn't have gone on with it.
At that point, at Let It Be, you were ready to go your own way, too.
Yeah, because...
For the reasons you've explained and others...
Because the other three were anyway, so what am I holding together? You know? But it would have been easier for me if we'd have come back to, like, the four of us situation, all for one, one for all, instead of all for, you know, all for themselves. It was getting more all for us, you know, for themselves, or ourselves. I include me as well. I want to do different things, but my move was minor compared to theirs.
In a few moments, we're going to leave the Beatles and
thank
talk
Christ.
About,
thank you, God.
And talk about how things have been with you since that happened. Just before, a couple of very specific questions. First of all, I can't interview any ex-members of that group without asking the question that everybody is forever asking. I noticed that you're wearing a sweatshirt that says the Beatles Reunion Tour 76.
Road crew.
Road crew.
Don't forget road crew. I'm on the road crew if they get together.
I'm going to play Robbie Reporter now for a moment.
Yes, go on.
A Beatle reunion. Do you want it or not? That's a yes or a no question. Would you like the four of you to get together one glorious night to do it up on stage live?
As a straight answer, yes.
Okay. Now, the second question.
But you see, that can't be the answer. No, you can't lay that on me, you know. It cannot be the answer. There's too much involved.
Too much involved
to get
it
together. Yeah, to make it possible. I would love for the four of us to play. Don't know if it'll work. I don't see why it shouldn't, because, I mean, I'd just gone from, like, the Ringo one was John, George, and I was the closest we ever got to a reunion. And it was fine. I mean, I love playing. And then I played with Paul. Well, it was interesting. John and Paul never played their own ex. They both played piano. Whatever that may mean. But, I mean, John on the last album played guitar. Paul wasn't on it. Paul is a fine bass player. John is the greatest rhythm guitarist around. George is a fine lead guitarist.
Yep.
And I'm a fine drummer.
Absolutely.
Whatever I may say. So, I mean, I would dig that. But then you've got to get into the rest of it, of getting it actually together. Like we're all busy. Like what time. Like which country. You know, like what are we going to do? You know, there's lots of other questions that go on that haven't been answered until the four of us. I've talked to John about it, and we've gone through it, and, you know, I've got my problems about it, he's got his problems. Just if it was a setup on the lawn outside here, and we just happened to be around, we could play, you know, then I'd love it. I'd love it, it doesn't matter where it was, but, I mean, that would be easy. But to set up this thing takes a lot of craziness.
Let me approach it from a different angle.
Okay, point from the left.
Yeah. If just recently there was a guy...
I've answered it anyway. I mean, I would love it, right? But we have to go through the problems to make it a fact.
Recently there was a firm offer. Bill Sargent, $50 million. One night, one gig.
That was for two shows.
Two shows, sorry. $25 million a show.
No, it was 30 for one. 40 for one and 10 for the other one.
A $50 million evening with a break for coffee and Danish.
Yeah.
If somehow or another, either Bill Sargent or someone else, some promoter, some entrepreneur, somehow worked out all of the myriad of problems, whether it be closed circuit, whatever the problems were...
That's not the problem. That's the easy stuff. We don't care about that.
Worked out how the money was going to be.
That's the easy stuff. It's the four of us. You've got to remember, it's the four of us sitting in a room deciding that we all want to do it. And we've all said yes, but it's never come about like I've said yes. I've never seen anyone at the other three who have said no. You know, heavy no. We've all said, I'd like it if it could be arranged. It takes the four of us to sit around and rap about it just to sort out, are we going to do Love Me Do like we did it? Are we going to do like we'd like to do it now? How would you like to do Love Me Do? How would you like to do Love Me Do? How would I like to do Love Me Do? I mean, just simple, basic questions like that is, how are we going to do it? Never mind, what are we going
to
do?
And if those simple, basic questions were to be worked out, you are all
for... If it was all fixed, or we'd spoken. Well, if we'd talked to each other, we don't need Bill Sargent. What do we need Bill Sargent for? We put it on ourselves. We get our own people in. Bill Sargent's only famous because he's the one who talks to the press. I personally have had two offers offering us to get, to, you know, money for us to get together, which is more than Bill Sargent's offered us.
More than 50 million?
More than 50 million.
How much?
That's the truth.
How much? What was the top
bill? Okay, well, no, it's top Bill's original of 40. It was 45 million for one show. Bill's come in on 50 for two shows, as far as I can read in the papers, because that's all I read. The first one was 40 million. He hasn't got that bread. I'm sure he could get it together. You could go out and get it together if I gave you a paper with the four of us saying we'd do it. So we don't really need Bill. I mean, it's got like Bill and us, you know. Christ, who needs him? I don't care if he does it, if we do it with him, you know. But, I mean, we don't have to do it with Bill. I think we'd be better off doing it ourselves anyway.
I guess the answer I'm looking for you...
So that's another question. Why do it with Bill?
I guess the answer that I'm looking for is the answer I've already got. If it could be worked out and the other three said they're in and they picked up the phone and they said, Ringo, do you want to play for the reunion? You would say...
Yes.